God is good all the time.
Good morning, church, and all our viewers. We hope you're all staying strong and staying inspired in the Lord. Praise the Lord. We are thankful to the Lord for a wonderful and anointed media service last week, especially the message by Reverend Dr. Bernard Ong entitled Spirit of God in Jesus' Life and Ministry. Let's remember Luke chapter 4 verse 18 to 21. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recover of sight to the blind, to set at liberty to those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Then he closed the book and gave it back to attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Hallelujah. I am Sister Maravik, your presider for this week. Our theme from the Lord for 2024 is look up and see your salvation and promotions draw nigh. A year of great promotion for His glory found in the book of Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Praise the Lord. May the good Lord continue to use us to be a blessing to many, and even unto the nations of the world. Amen. Let us continue to be united in prayer for the gospel to reach all nations. Praise the Lord. Many thanks once again for all your earnest prayers and faithful support for our digital discipleship church program. By the way, our presenters for this week are the following. Scripture reading is by Brother to Rachel Van Raja. Worship leading is by Brother James David and Worship Team. Exhortation is by Brother Jeffrey. Praise the Lord. Prayer for the nation of America will be led by Reverend Dr. John Leeming from FGCCI Main Church. The Word of God will be shared by Reverend Josephine de Vila from World of Life Cornerstone Glory Church, representing FGCCI Philippines. Holy Communion and Benediction will be conducted by Reverend Dr. David Quay, our senior pastor and spiritual overseer of FGCCI. Praise the Lord. Stay tuned, church, and let's look forward to a great year together. Amen.
Good morning, church, and all our viewers. Today's scripture reading is taken from the book of Psalms, chapter 27, verse 1 to 8. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and seek Him in His temple. For in the day of trouble, He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of His tabernacle and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me? And at his tabernacle will I sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, O Lord, be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face, your face, Lord, I will seek. May the Lord bless the scripture reading for today. Stay safe and God bless. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah to you, Lord Jesus. We send our spirit to you, Lord God. We give you all our glory.
Day and night, not empty lengths and surprise. Greetings, Church. Hi, I'm Jerry, and I'm your exhorter for this week. The title of my exhortation is Use What You Have in Your Hand. Use what you have in your hand. What do we have in our hands? Many times when we are in difficult situations or being asked to pray, lacking in our providence, or it may be other issues, we often look for excuses or look other places for the answers. But the answer is actually right there in our hands. God shows us in the Bible some of our heroes of faith using whatever is in their hands to overcome their situations. So let's take a look at some who overcame situations with whatever they had in their hand. The first one, let's see David and Goliath. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 40 to 51, it's about the story of David confronting Goliath. In verse 45, we read, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied.'" And in verse 46, "This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you," and so on. David was actually on his way to bring food to his brothers. In verse 20 says, "He only came to know about Goliath when he arrived there. He didn't bring any weapon but only his favorite slingshot, which he used to kill a bear and a lion, as it was said in verse 34 till 36. David didn't know that what he had in his hand would bring him victory. David used what he had in his hand and the name of the Lord declared to bring the enemy down. David was more mightier than the army of Israel, even though he was very young. David didn't look like a conqueror, but when God decides to use someone, that person doesn't need to look like a conqueror, for God is in control. God will always use those who are willing to do anything for the people of God. David had all the confidence because he knew what he possessed. He knew how to use the slingshot. He already had good practice when he killed the lion and the bear. He had full assurance that God will use him, and indeed, God did. David only used one stone, even though he picked up five stones to bring down the Goliath. He only used one, but actually it was the mighty hand of God that slung it. We too can win battles, but we must be consecrated and dedicated to God. He chooses us. He chooses those he can use. We don't choose him. As what is written in John chapter 15 verse 16, that he chooses us. We have something that God can use, and we can be the one he has chosen, and he's ready to use us night and day. There are plenty of giants in the world today, and it's time to bring them down. If you don't slay them, there are people who will not be set free. They are bound by all kinds of giants of sins, giants of lust, in alcohol, drugs, and other destructive giants. Jesus came to set his people free, and we are to continue his good works. We are supposed to be soul winners like our master. Next, let's look at Samson. Samson, when he defeated the Philistines. In Judges chapter 15, verse 14 and 15, here we see Samson was caught and surrendered to the Philistines, for they were seeking revenge against Samson. As we know, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson, and he broke loose of the ropes which bounded him. And in verse 15 says, he found a fresh jawbone of a donkey, reached out his hand and took it, and killed 1,000 men with it. Samson took something that was reachable. Samson did not have the strength to bring down those men, neither was he looking for weapons to kill his enemy. He knew that God was with him and believed that only with God he can defeat his enemy. He just needed something nearby or reachable to use it as a weapon. God didn't need an army because he had Samson. God chose Samson at an early age, and the Spirit of the Lord was upon him as he grew. In Judges 14 verse 5, Samson was confronted by a young lion, and in verse 6 says, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson, and he tore apart the lion with his bare hands. Here Samson fully relied on the Lord to bring down his enemy. It was not again by his strength and ability, but the Spirit of the Lord which came upon him. It was at this time Samson was living a holy life. As long as Samson had holy hands and a holy heart, no enemies could defeat him. Next, let's look at Elijah and the widow of Zarephath. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 8 till 15, here Elijah was instructed by God to go down to Zarephath to meet a woman who will provide Elijah with a meal, but didn't know of her situation. So, as we know, she was low on flour and was ready to eat her last meal with her son, and they are gonna die. But the prophet Elijah said, do not fear, and make a small cake for him first. And all she had in her hand was a little flour, but nevertheless she obeyed the prophet and fed him first before she and her son had their portion. And the result was she never ran short of food and oil for many days again. Verse 15 says, all the woman had was a little, but because she obeyed the word from the Lord. And in verse that is in, taken in verse 14, for thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. And here we see about obedience to God's promises, that whatever we have at hand, it will flourish and will not run short. For when God blesses, it is always more than enough, as we see in the next miracle that Jesus demonstrated. In John chapter 6, verse 1 to 13, it's about the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. Here, Andrew managed to find a young boy who had a little meal for himself. His mom would have prepared for him for the long journey. When Andrew asked the boy for his meal, the boy would have thought that Andrew was going to give his meal to Jesus. How excited he must have been, thinking that Jesus was going to eat his mom's cooking, and can't wait to tell her about it. But little did he realize that it was not going to feed one mouth, but more than 5,000 of them. And as we read in verse 6, Jesus asked Philip if they could find food to feed the multitudes. Jesus was actually testing Philip when he knows what he could actually do. Philip knew that Jesus has done many miracles, but he failed to see that the provider was just in front of him. And with the little that the young boy had in his hand, Jesus blessed and multiplied the bread and fishes. The crowd had more than enough to eat, and there were 12 baskets full of leftovers. This goes to show that the little we have, our talents, our finances, or even our health, whatever we are lacking, when we place it in the hands of Jesus, rest assured, miracles happen. Overflowing of blessing we will receive in whatever situations we are in. Jesus will ensure that we are well provided with more than enough. Many of us fail to realize what we have in our hand. We need to recognize that whatever it is valuable to God because He gave it to us. He gave us our talents, and everyone has at least one. So we have something in our hand that the Lord wants to use. We have nothing to fear and nothing to worry. Bible says in John chapter 14 verse 27, "Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." We may feel like we don't have anything in our hand today, but every child of God has something in their hand that God wants to use. But He can only use willing, humble, righteous, and holy people. So church, God has anointed our hands, and God has a hand in everything. Be blessed, church, and have a very good week ahead. Amen.
Hello everyone, this is Reverend Pastor John Eming. I would like to invite all of you today to join with me to pray for the nation, the United States of America, and the up-and-coming presidential election on the 5th of November. Lord, we come before you today, Lord, upholding the nation of USA, the nation of the United States of America, and the up-and-coming presidential elections, Lord, knowing, Lord, that this nation belongs to you, and recalling, Lord, that you have raised up many great leaders in the past who have put the country and its people as top priority in their agendas, Lord. And we come before you today, Lord, asking you to do the same this year, Lord, asking you to do the same next week, Lord, that you will raise up a leader, Lord, who will place the nation, the country, and its people before any personal agendas, Lord. We ask and pray, Lord, that on the 5th of November, Lord, you will encourage and enable everybody, Lord, who is registered to vote, to come out, Lord, to vote, Lord, to enable them to vote, that their voice will be heard, the voice of the people will be heard, and that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, Lord. We ask and pray, Lord, that your will for the election and this nation be done here on earth as it is in heaven, and that the elections will go smoothly and peacefully, Lord, that the ballots will be counted in a timely and accurate fashion, Lord, and that the will, the results of the ballot, the results of the counting will be accepted by everybody, and there'll be a smooth transition to the new government, Lord, to a new administration, Lord, and a new president, Lord, who has the ability, Lord, to reach out across a divide to bring the Democratic and Republican parties together, Lord, to put into place policies, Lord, that will allow growth and prosperity in this nation, that will allow freedom of worship in this nation, that will continue to prioritize the needs of its people first, O Lord, that will continue to respect the rights and prioritize the rights of the minorities, Lord, and will be able to reduce gun violence in this nation, Lord, and who will be able to continue to work with harmoniously with many, many nations around the region, Lord, and in the world, Lord. Most importantly, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And this president and the upcoming new government, Lord, will govern according to your will, Lord, with a heart for you, Lord, looking to you for wisdom, Lord. May you guide and bless the new administration, Lord, that you be a blessing to the people and a blessing to many nations. We give you praises and thanksgiving in Jesus' mighty and wonderful name. Amen.
Praise God, a blessed day to all of you. And once again, I am back for this program to share the Word of God. So our topic today is anger and forgiveness. So if you have your Bible, you can turn with me in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30 to 32. The Word of God says, "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom we are sealed for the day of redemption." Verse 31, "Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice." Last verse, "And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as Christ forgive us." May the Lord God bless the reading of His Word. There are people who are resentment to forgive. It is God's solution for bitterness, resentment, and hostility. So forgiveness is God's solution for all of us for bitterness, resentment, and hostility. You and I need the freedom found only through censure and completely forgiving others. The Lord wants us to forgive, because if we bear this burden of unforgiveness, we are suffering. We are not happy on that if we have something bitterness in our heart. So God gives us a censure and complete forgiving others, a way of forgiving others. So a few definition of forgiveness, anger, and wrath. It says anger is a strong feeling of intense pleasure, hostility, or indignation as a result of real or imagined threat, insult, frustration, or injustice towards yourself or to other important to you. Forgiveness is giving up resentment against someone else along with your right to get even no matter what has been done to you. Unforgiveness is the deliberate, willful refusal to give up one's resentment and right to get even based on the attitude that someone must pay for the wrong done. Obstacles to forgiveness. There are obstacles for forgiveness. Some people are hard to forgive because they lack desire. You don't want to forgive. That's why you have this obstacle of forgiveness, because you don't want to forgive. Rehearsing what happened, some people continue to dwell on the hurtful experiences. Pride, we may believe the other person should initiate reconciliation. You wait someone to initiate reconciliation. You, because of your pride, you cannot forgive this person that have done wrong to you. Another one is fear. Some resist forgiving to avoid looking weak, being misunderstood, or feeling rejected. If I forgive these people who sins against me, I might be weak enough, being misunderstood or feeling rejected. Another one, negative advice. Well, meaning friends don't always offer godly counsel. Partial forgiveness, people try to pick and choose which offenses can be pardoned. Relying on emotions, don't make the mistake of waiting until you feel like forgiving. So this is not the time yet. I feel not yet the time to forgive this person. So relying on emotion. Expecting quick result. Forgiveness can take time. Justifying the other person's action. Some people will realize what happened so that they don't have to forgive. There are obstacles of forgiveness, and what the scripture says about this. Scriptural teaching. Our fellowship with God suffers when we refuse to release others from their sins against us. That is in the book of Matthew 14, chapter 6, verse 14 to 15. Fellowship our God. So God will not hear us if we regard iniquities in our hearts. So how could be at peace with God if we have suffered unforgiveness, if we don't forgive other people who sin against us? So our fellowship with God is also bothered or hindered. So we should forgive over and over. In the book of Matthew chapter 18 verse 22, Jesus tells Peter that he must forgive his brothers 70 times 7. So 70 times 7. So we forgive our brothers. So if you forgive 1, 2, and 3, up to 10, that is always lacking. We need to give forgiveness to others so that the blessings of the Lord will not be hindered of our iniquities. So you and I must be willing to extend mercy towards those who sin against us, because God has forgiven each of us so much. We are freely forgiving. So 2,000 years ago, God who died on the cross, Jesus Christ, and His blood is a perfect atonement for our sin, and we are already forgiven. So that forgiveness, we receive it freely, and we give it to other people also freely. So we must deliberately turn away from anger and malice. In the book Ephesians 4, 31 to 32, important reminders. Friends, look at this. As a believers, you have the responsibility to take the initiative in dealing with unforgiveness. So if someone sins against you, you just take initiative and say, I'm sorry, sister. I'm sorry, brother. Please forgive me. So as a believers, this is our responsibility. We will not let others to come and to mediate us. To stand before us, we did not wait other people to do the initiative, but we ourselves we are responsible to act for it, to ask forgiveness if we done wrong to other person. Forgiveness will not always be easy or quick, but you can't allow it to take root in your life and turn into bitterness. Always remember, if you regard iniquities in your heart, the Lord will not hear you. So you need to cleanse your heart against this bitterness, to cleanse this your heart against this unforgiveness. So forgiving is difficult. Yes, I know that because it is unselfish. It involves laying down strong feelings and right while releasing the other person from his or her obligation to repay you. You may never forgive if you wait until you feel like it. I just wait that when I feel good forgiving him. No, you may never forgive it, but now you start forgiving it now. If you want to receive the blessings of the Lord and the acceptance of the Lord, we need to forgive. As a followers of Jesus Christ, we are a forgiving person. Christ forgive us, and that is a free gift. We also give freely forgiveness to other person. Remember, forgiveness doesn't always have to include going to other person and confessing your resentment. Approach that individual only if the Lord directs you to do so. You just listen to the Lord. If the Lord will direct you to forgive this person, and you just ask him, you just tell a brother, sister, please forgive me. So, steps in dealing with anger. He said, do not let the sun go down of your wrath. Do not be angry for the whole night. Step in dealing with anger. Acknowledge that you have been totally forgiven. God save you by grace, not because you deserve it. He has freely offered his forgiveness your entire life. He offered his forgiveness to our entire life. So the same gift also will be given to other person. We can easy to forgive. That is the one God wants us to do. Easy to forgive. Easy to give love. And easy to reconcile. Because we are the ambassador of reconciliation. And we can show Christ is living in us. And Christ is, the Holy Spirit is dwelling in our hearts if we extend love to other people. If we can offer his forgiveness, we can offer your forgiveness to other people also. Confess your anger to the Lord. So steps in dealing with anger, acknowledge that you have been totally forgiven. God save you by grace, not because you deserve it. He has freely offered his forgiveness your entire life. And then confess your anger to the Lord. Why are you angry? Recognize that your attitude has not been right with other people. Be specific in describing your hostility and resentment. So step it, confess it to the Lord. Recognize that unforgiveness is sin. Honestly admit that it is a violation of biblical principle. If you are angry, that is a violation of biblical principle, but you just quick to recognize that the unforgiveness is sin. Do not sin of your wrath. Do not let down the sun go down of your wrath. Just recognize it. Just be calm and ask forgiveness to the Lord. Ask God to forgive you. You may also need to admit to the other person that your attitude towards him or her was wrong. We are not perfect, I know that, but we need to be quick to forgive, to understand, quick to give love, and then lay down the anger through the power of the Holy Spirit and by the act of your will. Choose to let it go. Choose. It is our decision to let it go. So help. You need guidance. Helpful guidance is necessary also to all of us. If you have problem, if you have this unforgiveness, some people sin against you, you can ask guidance from your pastor. You can ask guidance through your elders and deacons. Do not be ashamed. Just ask their help. So that is helpful guidance. God will reveal whether or not you need to confess your unforgiveness to other who offended you. God will reveal. So if we cannot do it alone and so heavy in our hearts, we come to our pastor, come to your pastor, come to your elder, to the church, and ask them to help you. So they can help you. When it is in the case, make sure you simply request forgiveness for your attitude without doing and to why he or she anger you. So why are you angry? Why are you troubled enough? Because you are not satisfied. Because people are not satisfied. Where war came from? Because countries are not satisfied with each other. They are fighting with each other. That's why war came from. The disagreement and contentment, not satisfied. That's why it blows to anger. So if meeting in person is not possible, sit to chair facing each other, sit in one, and imagine the other individual sitting across from you. Then confess your resentment. You can also use this technique to practice confession, a wrong attitude, before attempting it in person. So you know what I say? You put two chair in front, one chair in front of you, and you sit down in another chair and practice. If meeting in person is not possible, set two chair facing each other, sit in one, and imagine the other individual sitting across from you. Then confess your resentment. You can also use this technique to practice for confessing a wrong attitude before attempting in a person. So you do the rehearsal. Practice, make amends perfect. So if you have already the peace of God in your heart, you can approach this person easily for you. How to know you have forgiven? The harsh emotions you have had towards other will be replaced by compassion. Harsh emotion you have had towards other people will replace into compassion. You will be able to accept others without feeling bitter. Even if we never change, you will try to understand why they acted as they did. You will feel thankful that God allowed that difficult experience to teach you more about the riches of His grace. Friends, we are saved by the grace of God, and we are completely accepted in the beloved. We don't struggle to run after the love of God, but because the moment that we receive Jesus Christ, our hearts will be full of His love and forgiveness. We are completely accepted as children and daughters of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if nobody will love us, we are pretty sure that our God loves us so much. Always remember that forgiving others is very important. Forgiveness. As God gives His forgiveness to all of us, we can also share the forgiveness to other people. So in closing, you and I don't have to hold into unforgiveness, bitterness, and resentment. We can escape the chain of self-destruction and entangle those who refuse to show mercy. When the Holy Spirit reminds you of the people to forgive, I hope you won't ignore His voice. It is my prayer that you barely and wisely choose to deal with those feelings, my friend. Allow God to set you free. You will never regret it. When the Son of Man set us free, we are free indeed. What we do is to receive Him, to hear His voice, to release forgiveness. God wants us to love one another and to keep our hearts upright to the Lord. holy is reverent our God is, and we need to be also holy and forgiving so that the blessings of the Lord, we can have it more and more. We will not struggle the blessings if we are cleansed and if we forgive other people. Always remember, if you regard iniquities in your heart, the Lord will not hear you, and the God is willing enough to help us. Do not harbor resentment, do not harbor anger, do not harbor unforgiveness into your heart. Just open your heart to the Lord. Just let the love of God that shed abroad in our hearts will be shared to other people. We forgive those who sin against us as Christ forgive us. We receive the free gift of salvation. We give also a free gift of forgiveness to other people. Friends, I tell you, God is a good God and He's merciful. His mercy is endured forever. We are so much loved by our Father, and He gave us His love completely. We are accepted in the beloved completely. His mercy endured forever. So let us pray. Father, I thank you for the forgiveness of our sins, O Lord. Enables us to forgive other people who sins against us. I pray, Lord, those people that are harboring bitterness, anger, and wrath, I pray, God, and I rebuke it in Jesus' name, and I replace the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of joy, the Spirit of love, the Spirit of understanding will be upon them. I pray, God, that you will bless all the viewers and the hearer of this program. Bless the management of this program, O God, this mass media. Bless also, God, the pastor, the bishop, Reverend David Cue, O God. And Lord, I pray that you continue to bless this station, O Father, mightily for your glory and honor. And thank you so much for having this privilege to be with you. And I thank you, God, that your words will accomplish in the lives of your people. Thank you so much, and God bless us all. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Morning, church, and all our viewers. Thank you once again for tuning in to FGCCI Media Channel. I hope that you are richly blessed by this week's media service, and I also hope that you are staying strong in the Lord. Hallelujah. I'd like to take this time to thank all the presenters for their wonderful efforts, especially our dear sister Mary Beek for her wonderful and cheerful presiding always, and also Brother Turai for his excellent scripture reading. I also want to thank Brother James David and the worship team for the wonderful time all worshiping God's presence. I also want to especially thank Brother Jerry for giving us such a powerful and inspiring exhortation entitled Use What You Have in Your Hands. And I know that you are richly blessed by this exhortation. I also want to especially thank Reverend Dr. John Leeming for leading us to pray for the nation of America, especially this coming U.S. elections. Let us continue to pray for a good outcome and for a peaceful outcome as well. Praise the Lord. I want to especially thank our speaker this week, Reverend Josephine de Vila, for giving us such a wonderful and insightful message entitled Anger and Forgiveness. She has already given us such a wonderful teaching and instruction about forgiveness. And I just want, in summary, I just want to read to you once again from Ephesians chapter 4 in verse 26. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Here the message is clear that we try not to be angry. Even when we are angry, it's not a sin, but angry can lead us to sin. And worse, anger can give way to the works of the enemy. So in fact, the Lord exhorts us to let our anger, the sun go down upon our anger. That means keep our anger short. And many times, in order for us to lose our anger, so to say, or overcome our anger, we need to forgive. Many times anger comes in situations that we are disappointed, or we are upset, or even when we are offended, we can become upset and angry. So it's so important to forgive. And Jesus has taught us, and Jesus, when he was dying on the cross, hanging on the cross, he said this prayer, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." It's the same. A lot of people do not know what they do or even what they say because they are influenced by the works of the flesh or they are influenced by the works of the enemy, and they have wrong thoughts that lead them to do wrong things. Of course, it's still their fault, but as Jesus taught us, they do not know what they do. So it's so important to forgive. Forgive. Forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Then we must forgive others who do wrong to us, or we are disappointed if they do not do the right thing as well. We can get disappointed and get offended. But do not let your disappointment or offense lead you to bitterness and anger, because you can open door, as Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27 says, to the devil. So it's so important to forgive quickly. And forgiveness is a great virtue of God's love in our life. Let us forgive others even as God has forgiven us. One of the most important persons you need to forgive is yourself. Sometimes we may make wrong decisions, or sometimes we may even offend others or get disappointed by our own self of the wrong decisions that we do. We must learn to forgive ourselves, because as humans we do make mistakes. We can learn from our mistakes and become wiser and become a better person. So remember to learn to forgive yourself, even as you forgive others. Hallelujah. And I hope this short summary will richly bless your hearts. And as usual, this is the first week of the month of November. So we're going to have our Holy Communion online. I'd like to welcome all our brothers and sisters in the Lord who is watching this media service in the body of Christ. If you are a born-again believer, you have received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, please, we are most welcome to join us and participate with us in this Holy Communion. As usual, we're going to begin a Holy Communion with the song, "It's Your Blood That Cleanses Me."
It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice and washes me. God's precious sacrifice. It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for coming from heaven to earth to redeem us and to save us. Lord, this morning we want to remember your goodness and mercy and grace on our lives. But as we partake of the Holy Communion, as you have instituted and instructed, Lord, we always remember of your mercy and of your finished work on the cross. Thank you, Lord, for your great compassion and for your great love for us. Church and all our viewers, let us prepare our hearts for the Holy Communion. And let us prepare the emblem of the cup and the bread. Let us leave it before the throne of grace. Let us pray. Father, even as we lift up, Lord, the emblem of the cup and the bread before thy throne of grace, bless, Lord, this emblem. Even as your people partakes of it, let healing flow through their body, favor and blessings and breakthroughs flow through their lives. Bless, Lord, this emblem, we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Church, let us prepare our hearts, for we need to partake of the Holy Communion in a worthy manner, with a heart of faith and with a heart of mercy. Just remember to forgive anyone who has offended us in our lives. Forgive them. And Jesus said, for they do not know what they do. Remember, you have been forgiven as well and be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. So, church, let us prepare our hearts for the Holy Communion. I'm going to read a portion of the scripture found in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, from verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and say, take it, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance. Church and all our viewers, let us partake of the emblem of the bread that signify the broken body of Jesus in remembrance of the Lord together. Reading from verse 25, in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Church, let's partake of the emblem of the cup that symbolize a new covenant in his blood in remembrance of the Lord together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and for your mercy. Lord, we are eternally thankful for what you have done for us, for our eternal redemption, and for our eternal salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you. Church, let's sing the song, I Will Sing of Your Love Forever. Thank you, church, and all the viewers once again for your participation in the Holy Communion. And as usual, we're going to give our tithes and our offerings to the Lord. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, even as we lift up, Lord, these tithes and these offerings and this love gift before thy throne of grace, bless, Lord, this giving for the advancement of your kingdom and for the glory of your name. That the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in every nation till the day of thy coming. Return back, Lord, your blessings upon every giver, a hundredfold, sixtyfold, and thirtyfold. Let your name be greatly magnified and glorified in the nations of the world. And all this we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, church, and all our viewers once again for tuning in to FGCCI Media Channel. And before I conclude this week's media service, let us close our eyes and hearken to the benediction for this week. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious towards you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant you peace. May the Lord stretch out His hands of favor and of blessings and of providence and of protections upon you, upon your family, upon your loved ones. May we remember to forgive others even as God has forgiven us. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. In the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, church, and all our viewers once again. Let us continue to stay strong and stay inspired in the Lord together.